is that we, as long as we abide by, your level of satisfaction with the noise of the location, there's nothing that I can do now to ensure that, because I don't know how much pollution we have. So I can't propose a solution to provide zero impact now, because I have no parameters to work off.
Right, but what I'm trying to say is that at a clear day, if it's the right wind conditions, you will hear it. If the wind is going the wrong way and it's some other background noise, you won't hear it. So what we need to know is that no matter what the conditions are, the weather, the wind, whatever time of year it is, maybe a day that we had a blanket of snow that came down, you'll hear everything, versus a fall day where you got all the leaves rustling and it camouflages the sound. It doesn't matter what time of year it is, what time of day it is, we need to know that this will not affect the quality of life of anybody that's living in that area. And so whatever you can do to mitigate it, even though you don't know what that is, like as you're saying, as you're testifying, we don't want to wait till after and find out there's a noise. So we want to make sure it doesn't occur, period, beforehand. And where you could sit and testify, or your professionals can testify and say, you will not hear this even if you're standing across the street. When we hear words like that, that'll satisfy us, not what the DB ordinance is for Holmdel or for any place else.
I think what the board is
summing up the board, what they're all saying, right? Board members?
Yes.
I think what the board is really requesting is a noise study. By an audio engineer, they go out there, do a study of the area now, and then based on the specs of your equipment, they can estimate the noise that will come over the equipment and the ratio of the distance versus the noise.
As I mentioned before, I have absolutely no problem doing that, because we've done it in the past. It's just that it's impossible for us to design something without having a benchmark, because again, zero noise is not possible for anything in life. You're not allowing us a fair shot here unless I can kind of see what we have currently, like the baseline noise level for us to be zero. I really don't know how to respond to that. I do agree that we would gladly take part in a sound study or whatever regulation or whatever requirement that you have, and we'll have no problem meeting that. It's just that zero noise is.
There are methods of lowering noise levels using buffers of different kinds, whether it's material, whether it's foliage, or we're trying to be comfortable that whoever might be sitting in their backyard having coffee is not going to be disturbing us in any way, shape.
I understand. I 100% understand that, and again, we can actually perform a sound study, because we need the landscaping is there, the fence is there. There are all these items that interfere with noise, propagation that we have in play. It's something that we have no problem, agreeing to.
So you have no problem maybe adding in some other buffers, is what you're saying?
Right. If the request is that we would like to mitigate the noise, I'm not comfortable saying zero noise, because the real world does not have, unless you're in the sound chamber, you're not going to have zero noise anywhere. And so it'll be irresponsible of me to say that we would agree to that without a baseline study.
I'm not sure.
Well, yeah, but that's what the board wants. You go out there, do a baseline study, what the noise level is out there today, and come back and tell us, is your equipment going to weigh more or less than that baseline? I don't think the board is asking for zero noise. That so everybody knows that.
I've heard no noise. That to me is zero.
You're asking us to put this in the middle of what? That's why I asked the question. You're not at the other end of the street where you're in the rest of the oil zone. You're asking us to put this. you're asking us to put this in a predominantly residential area, and that makes me very uncomfortable for the residents that live in that area, right? If it were me, I'd want somebody looking out for me and my house and my property rights, and my right to enjoy my house quietly. So that's why we're here asking you these questions. It's why, I know you don't want to, but you can see we're still troubled by why, what other better location might there be. I've actually been thinking, yeah, I know you won't like it, but you did talk to us at some point that you tried in other towns and you were turned down. And we never pushed you on why those applications were rejected there.
Just to clarify,
We didn't try in other towns and make other applications. I know there was suggestion by members of the public on that issue, and that is simply not the case.
We
did not file other applications for this particular facility. I mean, I've been working on this facility for 4 years, and we did not file other applications.
Your testimony might have been that you looked at
Other sites, absolutely.
Okay.
And that is, and if you want to hear more testimony of that, that again is something Mark Panicone will talk about. I know you asked about the county, particular county
I
property.
Around, and because, listen, I've been pretty verbal about the fact that how close you are to the street is just so disturbing to me. And I was driving around, like, again, I don't have a county to feel about it, but Robert Rhodes turns, and you have a lot of room in Holmdel Park there that would be set far back. You have nobody but the deer back there to bother you. And I'm just wondering if there's a better alternative. You go down stretches of Laurel Avenue that are a lot, are very commercial, with bus depots, and you go down Laurel towards 36. Of course, that's also not Holmdel anymore, so. But it just can't help feel that this location may not be best suited for this station. So I still have a lot to overcome for you to be able to get my vote based on my concern of how it impacts the residents who live in this area.
I can't speak specifically to that other site that you were just talking about on Roberts Road. I do know other sites were investigated on Laurel Avenue, but I'm not going to suggest that I know them particularly. I know Mark mentioned them at the last hearing, but the one other thing I would like to mention is it's not just is a site vacant. There's a number of other criteria, and again, I don't want to testify because I'm not a witness.
I understand.
But there's a number of other criteria that NJNG has to check before they can even consider a site. There's environmental concerns. One of the things that Mark mentioned was Green Acres funding. That takes it off the list right there. There's elevation issues. They can't be below the roadway. There's also, and I know no one wants to hear this, it's the proximity issue. It has to be by this Holmdel Road corridor that we spoke about in February and at the last hearing. So,
and I stayed on that road, right? The whole way we tore up the road, going, it's really easy to remember which roads got torn up for the gas pipe. So that's literally what I stayed on in trying to see where else might be better suited. And I know that's not our function, but in my mind, I'm trying to work these issues through to be a conscientious board member, and that location is just so difficult for me based on its proximity to all the residential homes.
I'm certainly going to have Mark come up and talk about those other sites again, but I can tell you from my own experience is that I know I have been working on this matter for 4 years to get to an application, and it's not because we drug our feet and we're taking a really long time to come up with a site plan for this site. It's because it was trial and error. We thought, oh, well, maybe we could get this site. No, that didn't work. And I know we spoke specifically about the Vonage site, and that entire agreement just fell through the Vonage.
You've done an excellent application. It's not
no,
a
I just want to tell you my experience. So Mark can talk about those other sites. I have no idea about the county-owned property. I'm sure if the site was even reasonable in terms of NJNG's criteria, they would have investigated it. There's a reason why we're here on this site. So I'll let Mark speak to those other sites and confirm whether or not they looked at that particular site you're talking about.
Okay, let's keep, don't bring Mark up yet, because then we're gonna open up a whole new avenue. Board members, we have more questions on all the testimony for this applicant witness. Because what I'd like to do then, before you bring up your other witnesses, open it up to the public. But keep in mind, public, that we have about 40 minutes left of this hearing. So if we want to hear everybody, I'm going to ask to see how many people are interested in asking a question, and based on how many hands, I'll calculate out and see how much time that's going to take. So raise your hands, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. So 12 people, I think we're going to limit the question to 2 minutes. And if you take longer than 2 minutes, my timekeeper Valerie is going to cut you off, because otherwise we're going to never get it done today. We're not even going to ask all the questions and get another witness on it. We just keep going. So, what's that?
Question.
Yeah. So the question's got to be a question. So don't start off telling us a whole story. Just get to the question right away. And it has to be on the testimony you heard tonight, not something that happened 2 weeks ago. We will have the engineer come back, and they will get a chance to answer questions to them. And then when the testimony is all completed, then we will be open to any question of the application from the beginning to the end. And then after that, we will be open to comments on anything you want. So there is plenty of opportunity to talk. So let's try to keep the questions relevant so we can get through this part and move on to the next one. With that being said, I'm going to start from one side and go across. So, person with the red here, I saw you raise your hand. You go first. Name, address, and question, please. And hold the mic close to you, because we want to get everybody to hear so they don't repeat the questions.
My name is Michael Kalpas. Hello. My name is Michael Kalpas. I live at 30 Candlelight Drive. A couple questions. You had mentioned that the bulk of the sound will come from the heater, not so much the gas flowing through the pipes. Is that correct?
Yes, that's correct.
Okay. Is it also safe to say that wintertime there'd be a lot, the heater would be working a lot more in the wintertime? I don't know much about the operation, but I would imagine that trying to keep the temperature down, would it be working maybe not all day, but a lot more during the wintertime?
The reason for the heater is the pressure drop of the natural gas. So the heater, independent of the outside temperature, you're still going through a pressure drop. You're going to have more flow in the winter, obviously, but the heater will still function based on the temperature drop due to the pressure.
So throughout the year it would work pretty much. It's not like in the wintertime, because it's colder out, it would be working a lot more to keep the temperature down. It just works better against the work based on pressure.
Right, it's pressure based.
Okay. 30 seconds.
That you had mentioned that the location close to the street, it doesn't necessarily have to be there, but it works better for, you mentioned, primarily safety reasons. If it's a matter of putting it, 200 feet back, and it'll cost a little more to secure it, is that possible?
I think you confused my statement. I mentioned that from a technical reason, we prefer to have it closer to the infrastructure. Ancillary to that is, also it raises more security issues for us, but from a performance standpoint, we prefer to be closer to the infrastructure.
But it is doable. It is possible to put it back there.
Last statement.
Anything's possible, but again, for the optimum operation of the system, we'd like to be as close as we can to the infrastructure.
Thank you.
I think the problem was, right, that the solar farm won't allow them to back this up anymore, right? That is the issue, and I think, and I just wanted to jump in, because I think the answer to your question is, we've all asked that question before, the solar farm will allow them to have any property behind where they are, correct?
Those are the only property rights we can get, because it is, I know we went through this in February.
Right, but that's
where the answer is. Right, I just didn't want to respond to a question he wasn't asking me, but there is the solar farm back there. We're 16 feet away, our fence from their first panel. They won't let us go past their fence. I mean, it's developed.
Thank you.
Scott Goldstein, 24 East Lawn Drive.
You testified that that your regulators, your heaters are a function of pressure, and you also just said that you use more gas in the winter. What's the duty cycle of the heaters going on during the winter months?
It's hard for me to say in terms of a time. It's not basically on a time. It's based on the demand itself.
Well, you just said demand is greater for gas in the winter. You should know from the volumes of gas you're pumping how much heat that you need to keep those regulators functioning. You got to have there's a design spec for duty cycle.
Right, but the heater operation itself is based on the flow that's occurring during the day itself. The duty cycle in terms of time, there is no duty cycle. It's a demand-based response.
Okay, on a 24-hour basis, okay, how many hours, how many minutes will that heater be on?
I can't answer specifically. Because it's based on the conditions at the site.
Could you research that and come back with that number?
It depends on the actual operation of the unit. Is it going to be on for 25 hours or 26 hours, 24 hours, 23 hours continuously? No. Is it going to be on and off several times during an hour? Yes. But how many times, I can't answer until it's in, until we have the actual demand cycle from what the actual customers are using. Design it to work at a...
Then fine. Then provide us a worst-case analysis for the amount of gas that those pipelines are designed to handle, and we'll take a worst-case analysis of how much those heaters are on. Can we do that?
Last question.
And the other question is...
That's it. You're up to 3 minutes. Answer that question for him, and then I'm going to move on. I'm going to go around the room, so I'm starting this side, and then I'll come to that side.
The answer is the same. I can't, from a design standpoint, answer how many minutes that this heater is going to be on.
So what I was driving to was the fact you got three heaters, three mount pipes, and about the heat noise source.
Sir, I'm so sorry. Thank you. I'm sorry, but you should be able to know on similar units. I mean, not exactly, but you should be able to know how often in a 24-hour period, how often these heaters are going on and off, an operator, right?
It depends on, it can change every day. The only thing I can tell you for sure.
On average.
The only thing I can tell you for sure is that it will be on several times an hour. It depends on the size of the bath. You know, again, if you have a heater that maintains its temperature for 30 to 45 minutes, it does not need to be cycled back on and off. If you have a smaller heater, you know, it just depends on how much demand it is, but it will be several times an hour.
And for how long? So you can't tell me how long. Like, does it run for a minute, 2 minutes?
It will be minutes.
Can you
but I think the issue is around noise.
Okay, yes. So right. The issue is around noise. I don't know if you guys are taking notes down, but I would suggest that you said you had similar plants to what you're proposing, so maybe you can get some data from those other plants so you'll have some hard fact to give us and say, ABC plant, this is what they do, this is how long, what happens.
I believe the question is around noise.
Yeah,
right.
I know,
so regardless of how many cycles it is, if it's two cycles, I think the gist of this is
the noise.
How much noise it, and I believe that the sound study can address all of these issues. I believe that's what we're after. Because if it comes on once or 10 times, it's still going to be deemed an inconvenience, right?
It's emissions too.
Okay. Let's keep going. Go ahead, ma'am.
Janet Niesig.
Help the down.
Janet Niesig, 7 Country Squire, Maine. So, first, go on with what he said. I think it's more than the noise. It's how often you're going to hear the noise. Because if you hear noise like a train once every day, that's different than if you're hearing this noise every few minutes.
May I have a question?
Right. So I'm saying, can you also look into the cycle time, the distribution of the plants. Okay, good. Thank you for providing these pictures, but do you have other pictures of a site that really is going to have these three stacks? Because they're looking at this, this does not represent what we are going to see. So to me, I would like to see pictures more representative of what we're going to have.
Okay, wait, let me answer that question. Is there other, is there any other pictures you can bring with three stacks from another site?
We don't have a unit that is a three stack unit by this vendor.
Of course not.
Also, all right, I've got my couple of questions. Also, this looks incredibly clean. The other unit that we saw last time we were here was incredibly dirty, and you pointed out fiberglass was off, and you said the building needed to be changed. What guarantee is there going to be from New Jersey Natural Gas that we're not going to end up with the unit that looks like what we saw last month, as opposed to this brand new one that looks painted?
Just to let you know that unit is not brand new. That's 3 years old. The point about the other location is that it's very, very different. It's in a commercial corridor. We in terms of a guarantee I'm not sure what guarantee you're looking for.
Well, I'm concerned that you might say it's going to look great, and then years later, when we're still living here and you're not around, it will look like what we saw last month. So.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you, ma'am.
But I just totally have heard that. So you don't have any three-stack locations?
We have. Not from this particular vendor. We have other two-stack units. We have similar units, but it's all based on size. It's not that this is some brand new technology. It's the same technology. It's just a different set of burners. It's a size-based criteria. It's not technology-based. We've installed almost a dozen units like this. It's just that the size that we have here. We have two stack units as well, which are similar, but again, it's not a third burner.
Right, but to get an idea of exactly the height and the aesthetic of it. Okay, I understand.
It's not a hard time. I'm here to answer questions.
So maybe you can bring us a picture of a two stack one if you don't have a three stack, so we can see that. Okay.
I don't have a problem with me.
The reason why I was very clear that this is a one-stack unit is, at least my understanding, is this is the same type of heater. And I know there were questions from the board as to what's the heater going to look like. The height of this stack, if I'm not mistaken, is the same height that we're proposing, but we didn't have a picture of the same type of technology with a heater that actually looks like the same heater, only with three stacks. So I wanted to make it really clear to the board so we weren't trying to fool you, but that's just the scenario. If there's a two-stack heater that's a similar technology, we could bring that too, but it won't be the same thing.
And nobody thinks different.
No, we understand. Okay, sir, your name and address?
Michael Riscala, 9 Hopbrook Lane. I had a question, but it was already answered, so I have one more question. You refer to the sound study. How relevant would a sound study be today, being that the leaves are on the trees, versus a sound study in the wintertime when there are no leaves? And being that I live in Hopbrook, I know that the sound travels from Holmdel Road, just even a car. So how reliable is this sound study really?
If there are criteria that you'd like to, or the board would like us to abide by in terms of the time that the study is done or the baseline, and I have no problem agreeing to that. But again, the sound study, if you do a sound study prior to the installation, you don't have the same conditions that you do when the unit is in operation. If you do a sound study now, you're going to have a different baseline than you will from a source standpoint. It doesn't change from our side in terms of the source out.
But you're right, if there are no leaves on the trees, then you have a different set of conditions. But, you know, we can't provide a solution without understanding what the current conditions are.
Right, so it could change. So now, today, if you did it today, it would be different than in the wintertime. So wouldn't we want to have one today, one in the wintertime, just to be sure of how it would impact me and the value of my home and my comfort?
I think that the study itself has to be based on our source. The environmental conditions are the environmental conditions. We can only control what our source produces.
Thank you. Still working on this side. You're the last person on this side, I think?
I think so, yeah.
Okay.
Pradeep John, so Greg, you mentioned that the pressure is 700 pounds right now with the pipe?
Yes.
What was it before the new pipe came in? What was it before?
That line was 575.
575. How much does the capacity increase by increasing? Is it linear?
No, it's not. It's not linear.
So how much is the capacity of the pipe, carrying the capacity of the pipe? What was it? How much has it increased? Like 50%, 100%?
I'm not sure.
How much gas can you deliver? So the carrying capacity of the pipe, has it increased with this new pipe by 100%?
No, the capacity of the delivery is not really going to change. It's based on the demand.
No, I understand. But let's say you had, infinite demand. How much could you deliver, one versus the other?
I'm confused now.
No, what I'm saying is
the station is what delivers your gas.
Right, but the reason
is
that
source,
you
put a
new pipe in, you have larger capacity, so you can serve more plants, right?
Well, the reason we improve our pressures are for system reasons.
Right, but you also increase the capacity, right?
Well, you're increasing the ability to deliver pressure more so than capacity. But yeah, the size of the pipe does. The size of the pipe is what we're really looking at here. I mean, your questions
okay, so
are...
Fine, then I'm asking the question wrong. By putting in the new pipe, you've gotten more capacity, correct? What I'm trying to get at, right, I want to understand. You keep saying that this has been done for Holmdel's sake, right? That all this new capacity and new infrastructure is being put in for Holmdel. We have one regulator right now in Bernard. You're going to put in three regulators. You've got a much bigger pipe.
Come up with a question. Your time's up. Come up with a question.
My question is it just for Holmdel, all this gas which is coming in? Or all these three regulators, all these pipes are just going to Holmdel?
This regulator station is feeding Holmdel.
It's feeding no one else.
This station is feeding the Holmdel area.
Is it feeding anyone else? That's my question.
This station?
No. You're getting three regulators. You're stepping down. You got three pipes coming out of four pipes.
I'm going to interrupt for a second because we have you can correct me if I'm wrong, we definitely heard testimony from the other sessions, that it will help benefit other towns in the area on the supply line, not exclusively Holmdel.
I want to know what percentage. Like, is it being done primarily for other areas than for Holmdel?
And if you don't have that data, you can put it on your list of questions. We can address it next time.
The thing about it, what we're talking about is a system. And again, the system demand is being met by a station and a series of stations. The piping itself that you're referring to on Holmdel Road is part of a loop that we have on Route 36 and also on 520. Those pipelines feed east and west along both corridors. This particular station is feeding this area. The gas is directed primarily to the residents here and the other subsystem. Now, does that gas
you know, can it feed other areas as well? Of course, but the idea is that the station is meant to serve this particular area.
Right.
Thank you. That's it. I'm sorry. I have to let somebody else get up. We're running out of time.
We do have questions. I mean, you should be
writing down
more time.
Well, sir, it's 10 o'clock.
Well,
so
we're going to answer the question. I mean, this is a big impact on us.
I told you earlier what the process is. Did I tell you earlier?
Yeah, but you made up that process. Why can't we have more time?
Because that's the process. This is the way this hearing is run. So please have a seat so I can let somebody else.
We could postpone it to another day.
We're not going to postpone it. We carry it.
Well, you carry it.
There's not going to be a vote tonight, if that's what you're
concerned. No, it doesn't matter. There's a continuity to questions.
Please, let's continue. Give other people a chance to have a question. Going, starting from the back, the young lady there, and we're going to work our way forward.
My name is Falguni Patel for Two Hop Brook. I just have one question. You mentioned the decimal about 55 to 62, probably 200 feet. Most equipment deteriorates, so how can you assure that the decibel will not go up after the first couple of years of the equipment?
I'm not following. The decibel levels are based on the sound at the source.
I understand.
And so over distance, it will decrease as you...
I'm asking a question about the quality of the machine. For instance, the boiler, the peak pump in my house is quiet when it's brand new. 2-3 years later, it starts to make more noise, and then more noise and more noise. Who will monitor the equipment so that the test you do now is assured? I have bought this $2 million house. I don't intend to move until I've finished my kids' college, so I hope to be parked there for at least 10 plus years. So who's going to assure me that the noise factor will not change?
Again, the health department ensures that we maintain our sound levels. Over time, as the equipment ages, we do maintain our equipment. If you're suggesting that we carry out periodic sound studies, I'm not sure what the answer is, but. If we agree to a sound level, we'll make sure that that's subject to inspection from the town.
Does equipment get louder as it gets older?
The equipment will not get louder as it gets older because we maintain the equipment. If it gets to the point where it's disarray, then the unit will be replaced.
I think that's what
you
were asking.
And just so everybody in the room feels heard, right? So the question from the gentleman before was, again, said, if you don't know, then you can just carry it. But to clarify, predominantly 80%, 60% of the purpose of this station is to serve Holmdel residents. Is there any idea of what benefit percentage this gives Holmdel versus other areas?
And she's putting it down for her questions, and you'll address it the next year.
I don't want to push you. I just want everybody in the room to feel heard and have an opportunity to ask their questions. So that's why I'm just trying to follow up
with you. And I'm just going to reiterate the testimony that's already in the record from Mr. Panchone, which is that it primarily serves Holmdel. But I understand you're looking for more of a percentage. I'm not sure that that's possible, but we will try and find out that answer. But the testimony on the record, I believe, is echoed by is primarily Holmdel.
Excuse me. I'm not recognizing anybody except for the gentleman standing at this mic.
Someone has to check that statement.
Period.
My name is Antara Colomini, 23 Country Squire Lane. I'm not sure if this has been done, but it would be good to have an artist representation of you that we would see. Antara Colomini, 23 Country Squire Lane. An artist representation showing the view that we would see, because with these pictures, we can't see at the scale how it would look at perspective of a house, for example, and I'm sure that the vendor will provide pictures of this three-stack unit that we can see. And the other question I had was regarding the exhaust.
Do you want us to answer the question?
No, I just ask you Well, you could ask the question with respect to whether this artist representation has been done.
I'm not sure if you attended the last hearing, but we do have a rendering that's based upon a photograph that is along Holmdel Road across the street. So as if you were driving in a car and looking right at the site. I'll get those out in just a minute, just so I can remember them all in my head. And then we have one we call the north perspective, which I believe is driving, counterintuitively, is driving south along Holmdel Road, so what your perspective would be there. That is a rendering, not a rendering over a photograph, but a different kind of rendering. And then we have another perspective looking north, or driving north, that we call the south perspective. And that gives you the perspective going, you know, away from the Vonage site, on all along Holmdel Road. And that was all testimony that was presented at the last hearing.
These are available to see?
They're here, sir.
Right there.
Okay, because that may address some of the questions that people had, you know, how big is this, the three-stack unit? This rendering shows the three-stack unit?
The rendering doesn't show the street three-stack unit because of the fact, and our landscape architect provided this testimony. I'm just trying to summarize in an effort to explain it, but we did have extensive testimony. It doesn't show it because based upon the location of the perspective and the landscaping we're showing, along with the berm and the height of the landscaping, the fencing, and what he was showing, a year in planting, I don't want to mischaracterize what he said, but he said it would not be visible from the right of way. Now, he may have qualified that, but I'm guessing now, is if you had some peek through a tree, but I don't want to qualify that testimony. You're more than welcome to look at these renderings, and if you know, we could have some additional testimony if the board required that, because that was again done at the last hearing. But they are right here, if that helps you.
Okay, your questions are up. I'm sorry. Hold your questions for another hearing. Next person, any more in the back? Okay, sir, go ahead.
Randy Rauscher, Blue Hills Drive. Mr. Sanders, you spoke about the composition of the emissions coming from the stacks and identified about 90% of the components coming out. It's that 10% that leaves me a little uncomfortable. And since we were talking about mercaptans and related compounds, these are things that are odor detectable at parts per thousand, parts per million perhaps, and I think that we should be hearing a little bit more about that remaining 10%. And I guess the bottom line is similar to the noise emissions. Will any odors be emitted, be detected outside the property line? Under heavy conditions.
Right. From the heater perspective, let me answer that. The combustion, you know, product of combustion, the mercaptans are burned in a combustion process. I mentioned previously in my testimony about the emissions criteria. We're subject to